Hello student, in this video we will see the another partitioning technique, that is input data partitioning. This is also called as input data decomposition. In the previous video we started the decomposition techniques. There are four decomposition techniques. They are recursive decomposition, data decomposition, exploratory decomposition, hybrid decomposition and speculative decomposition. In the slides there is a recursive decomposition, this comes twice, but there is a data decomposition, and currently we are discussing the data decomposition. Okay, sorry. So input data partitioning. See here, previously we have seen the output data decomposition. Now we are going to select the input data decomposition. Now what happened in output data decomposition? Partitioning of output data can be performed only if each output can be naturally computed as a function of input. In many algorithms, it is not possible or desirable to partition the output data. For example, while finding the minimum or maximum or sum of the set of numbers, the output is a single unknown value. In sorting algorithm, the individual element of output cannot be efficiently determined in isolation. In such cases, it is sometimes possible to partition the input data and then use this partitioning to induce the concurrency. A task is created for each partition of input data, and this task performs as much computation as possible using this local data. Note that solution to task induced by input partition may not directly solve the original problem. In such cases, a follow-up computation is needed to combine the results. For example, while finding the sum of sequence of n numbers using p processes where n is greater than p, we can partition the input into p subset of nearly equal size. Each task then compute the sum of number in one of the subset. Finally, the p partial result can be added to yield the final result. So that's why the input data partitioning is used instead of output data partitioning. Okay, because every time the output data partitioning is not useful. So this is what we are going to see. Generally applicable in each output can be naturally computed as a function of input. In many cases, this is the only natural decomposition because the output is not clearly known or prior. Example, the problem of finding the minimum in the list, sorting a given list. A task is associated with each input data partitioning. The task performs as much of the computation with its part of data. Subsequent processing combines this partial result. So now see, this is an example of database transaction. Same example, if you remember, we have discussed in output data decomposition, where we focus on the output atom frequency, atom set frequency. This column we focus on output data decomposition. But now as our main focus is on input data partitioning, so we will focus on this first part, that is a database transaction. Now in a database counting example, the input, that is a transaction set, can be partitioned. This induces the task decomposition, in which each task generates partial counts for all atoms. These are combined subsequently to aggregate the count. As shown here, now the database transaction decomposition is, or partitioning is taking place, and task 1 and task 2 are created after this input data partitioning, where task 1 contains the first part of the database transaction and the task 2 contains the later part of this database transaction. Now partitioning input and output data. Now, sometimes it is also possible that often the input and the output data decomposition can be combined for a higher degree of concurrency. So for the atom set counting example, the transaction set input and the atom count output can both be decomposed as shown below. Now you can see input and output data partitioning is also possible. Same example, database transaction. Here you can see the four tasks are created. The main data is decomposed into four subtasks, and where you can see the task one contains the first part of the database transaction and the atom set frequency, where the task two contains the first part with second part of atom set frequency, and now task three contains the second part of the database transaction with first part of the atom set frequency, where task four contains the second part of the database transaction with second part of atom set frequency. So what we did here, we partition both input and output data. That is the example. Okay, so this is very important. Sometimes depending upon the application, we need to select the output data, we need to select the input data, or we need to select both input and output data for partitioning or decomposing. Now sometimes it is also required that we must use the intermediate data for partitioning. So computation can often be viewed as a sequence of transformation from input to output data. Okay, so it means a series of computation is there, a sequence of operations you are performing in matrix multiplication or matrix vector multiplication or in the database query example. This sequence of transformation from input to output, this can be intermediate data. And in this case, it is often beneficial to use one of the intermediate stages on the basis of, as a basis for decomposition. This is what we are learning here. Okay. So sometimes we must select the intermediate stage as a basis for decomposition. So example will clear you. See here. This is the example of matrix multiplication. Now let us revisit the example of dense matrix multiplication. We first show how we can visualize this computation in terms of intermediate matrix D. So here, intermediate matrix D is selected for decomposition, and that D is again decomposed for a better understanding or for better operations. This will improve the performance of your parallel system also. Okay, so this is intermediate data decomposition. You can see here the first column is multiplied with the first row of the second matrix, and we yield or we get this resultant matrix D. Now the second column of the first matrix is multiplied with the second row of the first matrix, and we get the resultant matrix D. Now we need to add, as per the formula of the matrix multiplication, after multiplication we need to add. Okay, so add and multiply, this is the two operations there in matrix multiplication. That's why we are adding these two resultant matrix, and finally we get the final resultant matrix of this matrix multiplication. So this is what a intermediate data partitioning. Okay, now intermediate data partitioning example, that is a decomposition of intermediate data structure leads to the following decomposition into 8+4 stages. Here this explored in more detail. Same that as of output data decomposition, here only we selected the intermediate data for partitioning or decomposing. Okay, so intermediate data partitioning, another example, the task dependency graph for decomposition shown in the previous foil into 12 tasks as below. So here this example, 12 tasks are created. Now from this 12 tasks are there for this example. So this 12 task dependency graph can be drawn as per this figure. Okay, so this is about the data decomposition, where you keep in mind that the data decomposition, three types of partitioning or decomposing sub activities are there. First one is the output data decomposition. Second one is the input data decomposition. Sometimes we can do the input as well as the output data decomposition. And the last one is the intermediate data decomposition. Okay, Now, very important, one article is there, that is the owner computes rule. What do you mean by this owner compute rules? The owner compute rules generally state that the process assign a particular data atom is responsible for all computation associated with it. Okay, means the process assign a particular data is responsible for all the computation associated with it. That is the owner compute rule. So suppose the process is the P0 and it is assigned with some matrix multiplication operation 1, 2, 3, then that process is responsible for all computation associated with it. That is the owner compute rule. So in the case of input data decomposition, the owner compute rule implies that computation that use the input are performed by the processes. In case of output data decomposition, the owner compute rule implies that the output is computed by the process to which the output data is assigned. So that is the owner compute rule. This is also very important because later on we must know which process is doing which activity. And that is the owner process is responsible for all the computation associated with it. Okay. So this is the data decomposition technique that we discussed in this video. Previous video also we started this decomposition technique. Okay. I hope that you understood all these things. I revise quickly that data decomposition is input data decomposition, output data decomposition, and the intermediate data decomposition. Sometimes we also perform the input as well as output, and this owner compute rule is also important. These all things are explained with the help of two examples, that is a database transaction and a matrix multiplication. Okay, thank you very much.